So thank you very much for the invitation. And just a brief introduction, how this research happened. So this was my attempt to do some practical aspects of reinforcement learning. And there were some positive circumstances which allowed this experiments, namely, there was a student who is the first author of the two papers which I'm planning to discuss now, Błażej Osiński. He's joining LIFT next week. He's a, we did these experiments when he was a student at the University of Warsaw, and also simultaneously he worked at DeepSense AI. And these experiments required a lot of engineering power and a lot of resources. So these resources were coming, interestingly, only from private money, namely this was financed by Volkswagen and by DeepSense, no grants involved. We used one important resource, which is marked here on the right, a computational resource, which is public, which is the largest in Poland supercomputer. And it appeared to be very useful. I think that this usefulness, it's also a question how these things are operated, and this one is operated very efficiently. So one of these papers which I'm planning to present today is already published. It was published at ICRA this year. And another one is under review. There will be a clear split between these two undertakings. We started this project around 2017, to be more specifically. I met people from Volkswagen at NeurIPS in 2000, this was NIPS at that point, in 2017, and somehow managed them to co-finance this experiment. And the basic premise is to have a situation like in these two movies. So the movie on the left is completely artificial. This is just the Carla simulator. So it's an important ingredient of our project. It's a simulator based on Unreal Engine 4. And to the right, we have just a road in Wolfsburg. It's actually a parking lot next to the factory, to the Volkswagen factory. But a public place, so it's not restricted in this specific parking lot. Everyone can go there. So my idea and the idea of the Volkswagen team was to just test to what extent this kind of transfer from simulation to the real world is at all possible. How does it work in practice? What are the technicalities of this? And we put together what follows. So Carla, as mentioned above, and it's seven built-in maps. So the standard way of how it was used at that point is that six of these maps were intended for training and one for validation. And a custom-made map, actually more than one, which resembled the deployment area, but only roughly. It was not intended to be one-to-one copy or up to 1 meter or anything like this. It was more like an artist take on how Wolfsburg looks like in two locations. So about the architecture and training, these components were relatively standard. There were some nuances which will emerge in a second. So we used a not very problematic, quite robust policy gradient algorithm, an actor critic policy gradient, the PPO specifically. And an input, which as you can see in this diagram, it's a combination of RGB images, which are directly fed into CNN network and a segmented version of the same image. We used car metrics. I mean, in this experiment, it looked like a no-brainer, right? Because we have this metrics, so there's no, it would be pretty artificial to get rid of them. Let us say things like current speed and the position of the wheel. And perhaps more importantly, a high level command, which by this I mean commands such as turn to the left, turn to the right. And this was not set, I mean, it was set from just using engineering common sense. So we didn't try to have an ultimate set of high level commands, just something what looked reasonably useful, and it resembled the experiment at the end-to-end driving via conditional imitation learning, which we liked. I mean, the experiment we liked, and it was a kind of inspiration for what we were doing here. So semantic segmentation, this is an interesting point, because this was crucial to get a decent, one of the crucial components to get a decent behavior in this experiment. We used a good segmentator, which was brought to the state of the art for segmentation. And one important remark is that if one insists that some real world data was used here, then it is here, meaning that here we ended. This is based on human annotated real world data, the whole segmentation. The whole segmentation data set, it was mixed with synthetic data coming from Carla. Okay, so another now relatively standard component, namely the randomization, domain randomization. By this I mean that we were trying to make harder the life of the agent and expose it to various troubles with the input, meaning we were varying weather settings, which is one of the Carla features, and we're adding noise in various ways, just direct noise as Gaussian noise, and we're also changing, playing with settings, so feeding both low and high quality inputs. This is not a different, I mean, one of the aspects, I will be back to this point, but when you do this kind of experiment, I think that it's in a sense true about all real world RL experiments, that you need a better metric than what I'm showing now. And I will be back to this problem, what is a better metric here. We need good training scores, because if we cannot master the training environment, then definitely this is not going to work. It may not work even if we master, but without mastering, it's certainly a failure. As you can see from these graphs, it shows a significant and expected improvement with this extra randomizations. We didn't try to push it to the very end. It was not the goal. We don't have really ablations for which of this aspect of randomization was the most critical. Once again, we just wanted this thing to work. So meaning having a good training score on difficult scenarios. And why they are difficult? Because these are long routes. So this requires passing through, you can see here, these are in kilometers. And we have here three maps and nine real world driving scenarios, which were used in total, and five of them modeled in Carla. And what I mean by evaluation of models, so I mean that we tried various changes to the base training. So for example, just segmentation without RGB, it's a bit, I mean, it has its own problems, right? And so by 10 types of models, I mean here various tweaks to the basic architecture. But now back to the metric. So the metric, which is really interesting here, is the takeover metric. In my opinion, at least, this is the interesting metric. As you can see here, we have the takeover indication, and this means in practice that in these cars, we were able to fit four researchers, and one of them was driving this car. And by driving, we mean that sitting in the driving seat, and takeover meant that this driver was touching the wheel. So touching the wheel indicated that we entered into the takeover mode. And then in order to be back to autonomous driving, a special button was pressed. So this was the process. So when we see here takeover false, it means that it's autonomous. When we see that it's true, it means that this is the moment where the driver thought that it's too dangerous what this AI is doing. So here there are these are the 10 experiments and which are really ended up in the paper the most relevant of these experiments is are at the top, I would say, and when we go bottom the table, it's getting into more and more crazy driving behaviors, and these percentages which are indicated here, it means that these are just percentages of autonomy in a given scenario. So some of the scenarios were easier and some of these models managed to just get through. So this something what is indicated here as auto uni arc. This is an arc which you have seen on a previous map and which more or less, I mean, some of these models managed to get it always correctly. And here it was averaged through as many we were sitting in these cars for hours, to make the long story short, so and big hours. Perhaps it's one of the most important inputs from this experiment. We had a very good car, I mean, very well prepared for this experiment, and we managed to get, let us say, for the sake of this discussion, 100 hours of tests, which are exemplified by these dots here. And you see here SEMSEC only, for example. It's less hopeless than I would think. Continuous versus discrete, it's about actions. So it's a bit, it's information a bit for connoisseurs, but this architecture allows both, this neural architecture allows both continuous and discrete actions. And overall, we had a lot of troubles at the beginning with discontinuous actions, but then managed to understand our, so then we switched to discrete and then back to continuous, as more or less was the path there. So discontinuous means that we just provide a float as our action. So action, once again, this is turning of the wheel in this experiment, because we are using a controller to set the speed to 30 kilometers per hour. Okay. So this is a typical crazy drive. Yes, you see what's going on. The car is trying, it does not understand what's going on here too much, and it's turning from left to right. It doesn't mean that it hits cars, because this is the level of consciousness it had, that hitting something was like, we didn't have any security measure to prevent hitting, so the driver was really needed in such situations, but it's simply didn't understand that must follow straight this path, that it tried to go left and right all the time. Here is the regularized version, and as you can see, this is much less. This is much smoother drive and much more controlled. By the way, this is the scenario. This is the easy scenario. By easy scenario, I mean that easy practical scenario. Sometimes we had some pedestrians around here, sometimes some cars, but overall, this experiment basically proved that this training in simulation and these architectures are certainly capable of getting through this kind of scenario more or less on their own. Okay, one important side effect of this long hours in spent in the car is that we were able to get we had also recordings by humans, and exactly the same routes recorded by humans. And it's a what we managed to what we managed to get here. It's an important proxy measure for evaluating models without deploying them. So we wanted this avoid testing very stupid models, because first of all, it's dangerous, maybe not very dangerous, but still dangerous. And the second thing is that it's just costly, you know, it's human time, and both of the Volkswagen team and our team. So we wanted to minimize this. And this quite naively sounding proxy measure looked as a reasonable bet, meaning the deviation of from the human trajectory. So it doesn't mean that you have to, as slave, follow what humans was doing, what a human was doing, but overall it looked like a pretty decent correlation. There were some outliers, as you can see here, but overall decent correlation if something was indicating a lot of errors. I mean, a lot of, it depends on the scale. Maybe it's not a lot, even the 0.04, which we see here, but still it was clear that it's a measure which is helpful in distinguishing stupid policies from reasonable behavior. And there were interesting failure cases, probably for people from robotics. This will sound very naive, but still for us, this were some discoveries. So one of these failure cases is we noticed that we started with two car last scenarios, and these two car last scenarios didn't have lanes. So our AI was unable to just, it was unaware of the concept of a lane. And lanes were introduced in appropriate version of Carla, and then the model managed to get here, as you can see, policy trained on Carla. This is sorry for this. With double lines only, they simply don't pay attention didn't pay attention for single lines. And when we trained them on both single and double lines, they were able to see also, they didn't wait for a double line to say that that it's indeed the end of the lane. And as naive as it may sound, it was a helpful discovery that indeed there is an issue with lane detection being indeed, because there is no extra facility for this. So it was not done automatically. We really needed to learn about this in this experiment. Okay, so this experiment was deemed reasonably successful by our Volkswagen partner, and this meant that we were able to move to the second experiment, which was done in this year, like end of 2019 and 2020. The name of this project is Carla Real Traffic Scenarios, and this is the project which is still under review. What was the intention here? The intention was to use something what looks rather useless at the first glance, because these are just some recordings in one case from static cameras, but and the second, the new data set is NGCM, it's an old data set, and OPDD is a new data set. So OPDD, these are drone recordings, but this is the same format. We have only bird's eye view of the world. It doesn't look super useful for direct applications in autonomy, at least to my eye, but as was rightly pointed by our friends from Volkswagen, it can be used if we put it into a simulator. Namely, that we will use it for short scenarios. Short scenarios from real world traffic. And this is what happened in this project. It's completely open source, so just to be clear, this project is already accessible. but without description. So I mean, like the codes are accessible. Okay, and here are situations in a simulator, which are mapping the scenarios before recorded by street cameras or by a drone. So we are talking only about short scenarios, so few seconds, basically. For the sake of the discussion, up to 20 seconds, but actually it's less. And it covered a lot of situations, but so once again, just to be clear, we started from drone recordings and put them into the CARLA simulator. So this is once again a kind of artist rendering of the scenarios, and it was to some degree possible to automate, but it involves a human intervention. That how I would describe the process, and it led to the following final development for CARLA, to 9 new custom maps and a lot of short training scenarios. So it's in total over 50,000 scenarios taken on the base, generated on the base of these two data sets. And they are split into train and the validation. And they are intended to be testing behaviors like you have seen, a kind of how a given AI would behave in a reasonably condensed traffic with a lot of cars around. What kind of reaction would it have to this? What kind of control decisions would be made in such short scenarios? So the advantage of this, it's not only recovering front view from the drone camera or from a street camera, but it's also recovering all other views, because it's a part of the engine. So the engine allows you to look a posteriori from whatever point of view. It also, CARLA has also an a simulator of LiDAR if someone wishes to use it. It means that then the recording can be used for various sensory inputs, meaning that we are not anymore restricted to this bird's eye view, but we can take a lot of different views. So it's a we are not, I mean, as a team, we were not strictly speaking attached. I mean, like I like to think about this reinforcement learning approaches as a kind of a step, supervised learning with some degree of exploration, which we can control. So in this specific undertaking, we didn't try to reduce this exploration to zero and just do pure supervised learning. So in all experiments, we allowed certain degree of freedom, but just to be clear, this freedom is not as big as, let us say, in Atari games, where you can plausibly move the agent to whatever spot in a game. Here there are checkpoints, so meaning that the maps are equipped with checkpoints, and it means that the agent has a pretty strict motivation to follow this checkpoint sooner or later. So it starts from completely pure exploration, but then the model realizes that there are some rewards for following the checkpoints. So our concept of exploration here is that it's more or less like supervised learning, but between checkpoints you can explore, it's fine. I mean, we don't impose it. I mean, it's clear that this algorithm, which is pretty strong, will converge to this decision, and it does converge, but Like we are not enforcing strictly following what was strictly following some instructions, also getting these instructions here. Notice that it's an interesting case where reinforcement learning language fits into this, because we don't know really what were the decisions of drivers. We only understand that this vehicle was moving between certain checkpoints, this, let us say, our vehicle in this scenario, the ego vehicle. We don't know what was the precise speed and what was the direction of the wheels. So it's a natural situation when we want to leave it these decisions to the optimization algorithm, because we don't have that precise labels here. It's interesting also the comparison which was done in this work, which is currently under review, is includes some ablations. So the ablations are comparing RGB input with this bird's eye view. And it's an interesting case where this bird's eye view shows, which we can use for free here, right? Because Carla is providing us with this. It shows better results than RGB. It's perhaps expected for people who are coming from robotics that the simplistic view should make learning easier. An interesting aspect of this experiment is that we can also analyze the decision-making process. So we can see what influenced a given behavior of the driving agent, and in this case in a very precise sense. So to which other participants of the traffic the vehicle actually policy steering the wheel was actually paying attention. You can see here, it's more like a curiosity this experiment, there is another direction of this ablations to just one can think about this increased exploration, meaning that we are not enforcing any checkpoints, we are just allowing it to drive. There are various consequences of this. So one of the consequences is that it slows down learning. Here you can see a not so major policy that the green vehicle is cannot decide to enter the roundabout because it's not encouraged. The absence of checkpoints means that it's not encouraged to actually go there. It doesn't want to take the risk because it doesn't have an immediate reward. The reward is sparse in this experiment. This would be it for my presentation. I can privately share the paper, this unpublished paper, which also refers that if someone is interested, then I can do this after. It's not published on archive. It will be like I think next week. The paper will end up on archive. Thank you very much,
Henryk. Thank you very much for the talk. Let us know, we have plenty of time for questions and discussions. So is there a question from the audience?
Yes, I have a question. Thank you at first for the very nice and interesting talk. Am I too quiet? Should I, or can you hear me well?
It's okay. It's a little quiet, but I think
turn up the
it's still
volume.
Fine. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, how hard is it actually? So, can you elaborate maybe a bit more on how hard it is to map the trained reinforcement learning agent back to the real world car?
No, it's one can say, okay, if you want to take a completely you have in mind the first or the second experiment or both?
Both actually.
Mm-hmm. one has to calibrate expectations, meaning that I think that one aspect of one difficulty, at least a technical difficulty for us, is that when we were so there is no technical barrier there. Basically, we were connecting our laptops to a USB port in the car, and it worked in real time. So there is no real time issue, because we are not intended to issue a lot of commands. We are intended to issue at a speed something like 1 per second or even rarer. So there is no problem here. But regarding obviously the domain shift, so this is a big issue, and I think that my personal point of view is that one has to restrict the environment much further than what we were doing. And I'm aware of such experiments in industry. So there are industrial simulators used by other companies which are operating in restricted, simulators are operating in restricted environments, and companies are operating in pretty controlled environments with humans, when everything is more or less under control. So I mean, for example, cleaning robots. And then for cleaning robots, you can get it to perfection. And I'm not joking. I mean, I have a student who is doing this, and it's not a Volkswagen experiment. It's actually not a public experiment. You can get a simulator which is for all practical purposes one-to-one correspond. So we can basically, the origin of this experiment was that these guys wanted a simulator to test quickly new optimization ideas. And this is why they didn't want to train anything there. They just wanted to test new heuristics. And but the perception of this cleaning robot is done in such a way that it naturally leads to a 2D map. So it's not interested in 3D rendering of anything. So we have a 2D simulator, and for those 2D, you can go for whatever crazy RL algorithm as long as it's a strong one. It trained the simulation and just let the robot run. It will run. It will run very well. And, so I don't see an issue here. But for general experiments, like, for example, what we were doing in uncontrolled weather and with a lot of other uncontrolled situations, I think that the success rate is basically the amount of human intervention. So you cannot let this car drive on its own. No way. At least not with this policy. This whole control system, the whole logic of this control system is way too shallow to drive without human supervision all the time. Does it answer the question?
Yes, kind of. A follow-up question would be if, so you plugged a laptop into the car, so if think you used CAN messages to control the car in the end?
So, you know, I'm coming from software engineering, actually originally from mathematics, and then I do my habilitation in computer science, and our department is very much oriented towards software. So very little, and the good thing that in Volkswagen, I didn't have to learn it. So meaning that I still don't know anything about the hardware they put there. So my only obligation in this experiment was to provide a TensorFlow model and use an interface, and a Python interface developed internally by Volkswagen. And it was taking our instructions from the TensorFlow model and pushing it to the car stack. So we didn't know. Maybe there are some hard problems there, but fortunately they were solved before we appeared there.
Okay.
Is it an okay answer?
Yes, of course. Thank you.
It's a very good stack. From software engineering perspective, I was very happy with this. We added some features to this stack, but overall it was strangely never failing us. Our policies were failing us, but not the stack.
Definitely a very, very interesting project with Volkswagen. So,
I was very happy. For me, it was unique. I mean, look, looking from Warsaw perspective, we don't have a tradition of collaboration with industry. I mean, like a serious industry in particular. So I was, my bosses were happy. I was happy. I hope to continue with this Volkswagen team, perhaps with other industrial teams. I think that this was really interesting. Also led to a reasonably good PhD thesis. So it is from my perspective as a professor, it was a success. Just one small remark, which I didn't make at the beginning. So I'm hired by Google, but this is not a Google experiment. Just to avoid any misunderstanding here. I'm only in supervisory role here. So I'm a Google employee, but this was not finance or supported or whatever it's.
Thank you. Do we have more questions from the audience? Actually, I was curious in your first model, which was not regularized, there were these oscillations, right? The car was going back and forth. And I'm just curious, why do you understand why this is happening? Why wouldn't it just go straight?
You know, it's a stupid thing. It's a stupid thing, and it just shows that we are not coming from robotics. That's, I think, that like proof. Because I'm explaining how does it work. So we didn't enforce. So these are naive algorithms, and they are learning the distribution, meaning that given an observation, it tries to answer. Okay, the steering wheel position should be this and this. And what does it mean that it learned? It's never a direct answer. It doesn't tell us, not with these algorithms at least. It tells us a distribution. So what does it mean that it's a distribution? It means that we are getting, we have to fix a distribution in this experiment, for good or for bad, this was a Gaussian distribution. It means that multimodalities were not allowed. You have to make a direct decision, like one decision at a given time. And the mistake, I would call it this way, was that we hoped that this algorithm is strong enough to realize that it makes sense to narrow down the standard deviation of the Gaussian, because it's a learnable parameter there. And it was not incentivized to do this, so it never done it. It's as easy as this. So it was not incentivized to go to zero. And this regularization is basically a mechanical add-on to the loss, to the learning loss, which forces standard deviation to go to zero. So I'm assuming that if someone did robotics before, which was not our case, so then this idea would emerge much earlier. But for us, it was ended up as an important, I mean, like going without this regularization was an important ablation, which we learned in the process of building this system. Thanks for this question. I want to be clear about the background and about the setup of this experiment. So we were hired because we looked like a plausible software engineering team. Mm-hmm. So that was the starting point. They were responsible for the robotic part.
No, thanks. Thanks for clarifying. I come from a very different field, so I was just curious. I'm looking at this from an outsider's perspective, and it's just something I was curious about.
So for people who are doing classical machine learning for robotics and they hear about this reinforcement learning, so I said it during the talk, and maybe I should just underline it, that think about this. For example, at Google, I'm doing reinforcement learning as a kind of supervised learning. So we don't have any special algorithms. We have just special losses or special training procedures, one would say, but everything is used a stack intended for supervised learning. It has some consequences, so there are some error algorithms which insist on, but not this one. This one can be reduced to a supervised algorithm. Think about this as supervised learning with some degree of exploration, which is legally added, like mathematically added with some justification. So we want this agent to move on its own to some degree, but you know, not too far, because it will be crazy. So, I mean, at least it will take a lot of resources to learn anything. So that's one comment about when someone comes from the outside. So don't think about this reinforcement learning here as a kind of AlphaGo stuff, which is also reinforcement learning, but it requires a lot of emphasis on complicated, very costly exploration, not for driving. For driving, I would think about this, that we want a bit, like, you know, not to stick to this trajectory, let this agent visit left and right a bit, you know, within reason.
Maybe, well, let me ask if there is another question from the audience first. What about the unexpected? So in these difficult, maybe more difficult paths or routes, maybe you trained on, in the,
are there
events, like rare events, unexpected events, or is that something you would look at in the future, where maybe an obstacle comes into the way and things like that?
No, that's obviously like an extreme for this kind of naive control systems. Mm-hmm. This would not survive mm-hmm. a really unexpected event. But there are, I think that an interesting area is to stratify which of the expected events are puzzling the system. So my impression was that there are, so having a lot of space around was apparently quite problematic. We don't have a very precise measurement for this, but my impression as a person who was doing these recordings in the car was that more space meant that this car was puzzled by this unexpected freedom of movement. And these situations were definitely harder, which is a kind of negative news, but one can argue, okay, maybe we should just then put more experience into this car, allow it to drive more freely. It would cost more resources, more, when I use the word resources, I have two dimensions in mind. The training resources, meaning how many hours in simulation one is willing to spend. Let us say here, once again, for the sake of this conversation, I would put it like 1 million hours for getting in the simulation. How many millions you want to spend, or billions perhaps, in order to get a better coverage. So I think that the answer should go along the lines that when we are pretty sure that overall we have a capability to do full control, then spending these billions will be justified in simulation. At the moment, it's more about understanding the limitations of the method and understanding how much let me put it in from another direction. So the simulators which are used for the simulations here are Unreal Engine. So Carla and the whole development is based on Unreal Engine. And I think that one of the aspects, which I mean, like a futuristic aspect here, is that one can think, okay, let us try this simulator to make more, because it's intended, Unreal Engine is not intended for AI. Unreal Engine is intended to entertain humans. The fact that we are kind of convinced that this is a nice image doesn't mean that AI should be convinced. One of the future interesting directions, like from a development point of view, I would say that developing simulators which are specifically addressing needs of AR architecture. This looks to me like a kind of interesting futuristic topics.
Yes, thank you. Final chance, final call for questions.
If no one has questions, I would ask a few more.
Maybe. Please go ahead, we have still time.
Okay. So how long did training the agent actually, for how many hours have you trained the first agent, for example?
So you have to bear in mind that we were granted this experiment by Volkswagen because of the software engineering aspect and because these people read our previous work on parallelization of learning. Parallelization of reinforcement learning. So it's still a difficult topic, but the point is that whatever I quote as a number, it's a bit fake because you need a very strict measure of time there. Maybe better to put it this way, that human measures of time are inadequate here. Because we have this factor of how many agents we want to train in parallel. So this is this distributed aspect of reinforcement learning. And if you have infinite budget or a very large budget, like a corporate budget for computations, then one would go for maxing out this number of agents going into perhaps, like in this AlphaGo experiment, into literally thousands, simultaneously doing actions. We were operating on the level of 60. So 60 copies of the AI was training simultaneously. And then another factor, like the way how I think about this parallelization is not in seconds, but in the interactions. So you interact with the environment, make a decision, and it's your unit of cost. So the unit of cost is how many interactions you have to make in order to learn a policy. And here it was never completely optimized by us in the setup, but around 100 million interactions with the environment, it was usually enough to learn a scenario. So meaning that if you want to drive, and even let us say reasonably complicated scenario in this range, no, without going into billions of interactions.
Okay.
So, but it's still, it's an active area of research to reduce this number and to drop this parallelization or reduce parallelization. And instead of this, use better, for example, human trajectories. So this algorithm is not good at this. It cannot realistically use human trajectories. It can use, but it's a kind of fake. I mean, you can put it, but it doesn't like it. The algorithm doesn't like it. For example, at Google now I'm working on an algorithm which is targeting this. I mean, actually, we were working even before I joined Google on an algorithm which specifically targets limiting the number of samples. So do something useful within 100,000 samples. So you allow 100,000 interactions. So these are amounts which are possible to gather by humans, 100,000 decisions understood here that, let us say, for the sake of this discussion, we are taking something like 5 decisions per second at 5 hertz. So 100,000 is then completely realistic. It's possible to gather them via just even relatively small team. The question, like better algorithms or more sample efficient algorithms can realistically train using this amount of like this more modest amount of samples, but reinforcement learning currently doesn't have a killer algorithm which would be sample efficient. So you have either killers which consumes hundreds of millions, or you have experimental algorithms like the one I'm working on now.
Okay, thank you. So 100 million interaction doesn't sound very much if I compare it to Atari agents, which take about 30 million frames.
It's blown up. I mean, I can train Atari within 1 million.
Yes, of course.
But with this experimental algorithm. They have a lot of other problems, but this 30 million or 100 million or 2 billion, it's just, it's just a way how industry people tell us that, okay, we have a lot of compute and we are not afraid to show this. Here I'm not operating as a representative of a corporation, so I can openly say that it's a kind of advantage which you have at the corporation that you can allow this huge compute, and they don't calibrate usually, unless this is the essence of the project. Usually they don't calibrate for sample efficiency.
Yes, but yeah, still training an agent for a game and training an agent for a car and not having a too large difference between the overall training frames is still impressive to me. I mean,
bear in mind that it's in some respects an easier exercise than Atari, and I'm explaining why. because Atari doesn't have this concept of checkpoints. So you can do this. I mean, there are experiments with Atari, which for some various reasons, they use some kind of checkpointing, but this is more an exception. And I don't think that there is a benchmark for this, for any checkpointing. We are consciously checkpointing, meaning that we are saying, go here, go here. I mean, we are not saying this explicitly, we are just giving a reward for crossing a checkpoint. Actually, in arbitrary, you can skip some checkpoints, this is fine. But this checkpointing means that you limit exploration to, in practice, this algorithm will tend to limit exploration. We are trying to make this game reasonably simple. This would be my answer, not to overdo. Consciously, because, you know, it's just a trade-off. It's just a matter to see whether it makes sense at all, whether we can see any patterns in the real world, which somehow correspond to design decisions. So this paper was about this, I mean, this ICRA paper. It was not about getting an ideal policy for driving. So ideal policy certainly would need more capacity. Mm-hmm. And it would cost much more, billions, perhaps more than billions of samples too.
Okay, thank you. Can you send me the other paper, by the way?
Sure. Send me an email and I will do this.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Is there our final question from the audience? We have a few minutes left. If not, if there isn't any further question, I'd like to thank our speaker again. Thank you very much, Henryk, for being here, for giving the talk and for answering all the questions. It was a pleasure.
Thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm really attaching, I'm really attaching a lot of importance to this undertaking in Görlitz, and I think that it's a new thing, relatively new, and I hope that it would be important also, I mean, like for both researchers in around this era in Germany and in Poland, and I'm really pleased to be able to say something on topics which are potentially interesting here.
Thank you very much. Invitation. Thanks for your support. Thanks again, and we will continue in 5 minutes with the next speaker.